A very warm welcome to the Ken Raj Memorial Lecture. And I must say that this is the first time that the Center for Development Studies is doing a Ken Raj Memorial Lecture. So far, we have been having Ken Raj Memorial Days, where one of his close associates used to reflect on his contributions to the center, as well as to larger development economics community. And beginning this year is very important because this year is also the 50th foundation year of CDS, and we are about to conclude our 50th foundation year celebrations, and this is one of the most important events in that celebration. Now, I don't need to speak too much about who Professor Raj is and so on, because all of you are familiar with him. And as you know, he's one of the founders of the Center for Development Studies, and has been very much instrumental in shaping the future trajectory of the Institute. So in its 50th year, we owe a great deal to him. And one way of remembering him is to have an academic event in his memory. And I didn't have to think too much about whom I should be inviting. And we have here a very distinguished alumni of CDS, and who also is a very distinguished alumni of CDS, who also is actually a very close associate of Professor Ken Raj. And so he's eminently the right person to give this lecture. Now, let me briefly introduce Dr. Mihir Shah for those who are not familiar, especially for our new students at the center. Dr. Mihir Shah has had an excellent academic record. He did his master's in economics from the Delhi School of Economics, and getting a first rank in his batch. And subsequently, he joined the Center for MPhil in Applied Economics, and then went on to do his PhD in economics. And he completed that in 1984. And in 1990, he founded, along with others, he was one of the founders of the very important non-governmental organization, which is based in Bhadla in the Devas district of Madhya Pradesh, which is concerned with water and livelihood issues. Okay. And in fact, when we say that our alumni is working in various fields, such as non-governmental organizations, etc., we always refer to basically Mihir and his team, and because they have played a very important role in the in improving the livelihood of poor villagers, not just in their immediate area of work, but also in the state of Madhya Pradesh. But Mihir has also been an academician. He has been publishing very regularly, and he has even books. So his academic publication record is even rivaling that of a normal academician in a normal academic research institute. Subsequently, he became the youngest member of the Indian Planning Commission during 2009-14, and he's looking after again his area of interest, which is water resources, decentralization, and rural development. And he has been very much interested in developing a water policy for the country, and in fact, he's chairing a national committee on that. A very warm welcome to Dr. Mihir Shah to virtually this time to the Center for Development Studies, his alma mater, and we look forward to your lecture. And his the title of his lecture is Reading Professor Ken Raj in the Age of Free Market Fundamentalism. So now the floor is open to Dr. Mihir Shah, and you could take as much time as you want, and I believe you are going to speak for about 45 minutes and thereabouts, and after that we will take a few questions from the floor. So over to you, Dr. Mihir.
Thank you so much, Professor Sunil Mani. It's really a great pleasure and privilege for me, firstly, to be back in CDS, even if virtually, an institution that really groomed you know, an entire generation of youngsters like us, and we have been sending in our messages on the 50th you know, year celebrations. So I'm not going to say more on that, because you'll all see it in the souvenir which Sunil is so nicely bringing out. But it's an even greater privilege because we are remembering the person who founded this institution, our alma mater, and it's actually a great honor to have been asked to deliver this lecture in memory of Professor K. N. Raj. So without much more ado, I will start. It's I have written out the lecture, and a lot of it is going to be reading K. N. Raj, as I'm saying, reading K. N. Raj in the age of free market fundamentals. It may not be wrong to say that we are living in the age of free market fundamentalism. For at least the past four decades now, economic policy making globally could be said to have been in the thrall of a blind and dogmatic adherence to the notion that a progressively reduced role of the state in the functioning of the economy would automatically deliver greater economic growth and welfare to the people. Summed up as the Washington Consensus, it proposes reducing the role of government and moving towards greater privatization, liberalization, and globalization of economic activities. Little attention has been paid to the specific conditions within which, or the particular sectors of the economy where, reducing the presence of the state could help. My own recent work has focused on arguing that both in water and in agriculture, such a notion of reform is deeply misguided. If we are to resolve India's interrelated water and agrarian crises, what we need instead is to improve the quality of state intervention, build state capacity, and strengthen civil society action. Contrary to what the free market fundamentalists would have us believe, overwhelming evidence over many years from all over the world indicates that it is the state that has played the leading role in provisioning the most critical aspects of life: water, sanitation, education, health, food, and nutrition. Indeed, recently it has even been argued by the MIT economist David Autor that the rise of Donald Trump to the US presidency could have had something to do with the blind belief in the positive impacts of free trade, which led in the United States to a lack of focus on taxation of increasingly mobile capital, adequate safety nets, and retraining policies for workers who were adversely affected by global competition. The obsession with cutting the deficit or austerity, another holy grail of free market fundamentalism, just did not allow for consideration of social security and welfare options, even under democratic administrations. The continued decimation of the countervailing power of the working class, again seen as inimical to free markets, only intensified growing inequality and poverty, all of which contributed finally to the coronation of Donald Trump. Now, such a scenario would have been virtually inconceivable for a thinker and policy maker like K. N. Raj. Agree with him or not, the one thing everyone acknowledged about Raj is that he was no fundamentalist. Indeed, quite the opposite, more of an iconoclast, if you will, always challenging prevailing orthodoxies, whether of the left or of the right. So reading him again today, what can we say about how Raj would have weighed in on this free trade debate? To understand this, let me take you back 55 years when trade liberalization first came to the shores of independent India, more precisely to 6/6/66, the day of the devaluation of the rupee, the 6th of June 1966. It happens to be 6/6/66. Raj was an active participant in both the academic and policy debates around the issue, and he took precisely the kind of balanced, non-dogmatic view that I would commend to all students of economics. I begin by quoting a few lines from a very famous paper Raj wrote titled Growth and Stagnation in Indian Industrial Development in the 1976 annual number of the EPW. And I quote, "Unfortunately, a large number of persons belonging to my profession in this country, trained and fostered in neoclassical economic theory, cannot forget what they learned from standard textbooks and from their mentors in the more advanced industrial countries. The one thing I would like to say, and with all the emphasis I can command, is that I do not agree with much of the analysis and a large part of the policy prescriptions of such economists when they deal with the problems of countries such as India. This does not mean that I do not attach any importance at all to the market mechanism or the desirability of using it wherever it helps, nor am I unaware of the limitations of administrative controls and their abuse. What I do not subscribe to are simple magical solutions for the problems faced by Indian industry, such as devaluation and import liberalization sustained by more foreign aid as recommended and accepted in 1966, unquote. This was written 10 years after the event. But what was Raj saying real time? A careful examination of the debate surrounding the 1966 devaluation makes fascinating reading. Jagdish Bhagwati and T.N. Srinivasan were the primary advocates and defenders of the devaluation decision and had cast aspersions on Raj's opposition, or at least the inconsistency of his positions. They seemed to suggest, in Raj's own words, that, and I'm quoting Raj himself about what he felt Bhagwati and Srinivasan were saying about him, quote, "K.N. Raj had acted like a weathercock and therefore had been rightly exposed in Parliament by the Prime Minister," unquote. In actual fact, Raj had the much more sophisticated and intellectually nuanced position. Raj had been in favor of rupee devaluation ever since 1964 and had written an article in the Times London in 1965 arguing that export subsidies were not helping and needed to be done away with as far as possible through an adjustment of the exchange rate of the rupee. However, when he learned that the Americans were pushing for import liberalization and aid to be dovetailed with devaluation, he expressed his strong opposition. He did this in a confidential note he was asked to prepare by the Prime Minister herself in February 1966 to help her in her forthcoming discussions with the US President on the issue. In the note, which was titled "Economic Aid from the United States," Raj argued, and I quote, "While devaluation might help India in export promotion, its being tied to import liberalization and massive aid would not appear to be in the long-term interests of the country. There is certainly a case for considering devaluation as a substitute for measures of export promotion that have now the effect of diverting the foreign exchange earned to low priority uses and of generally distorting the pattern of use of scarce resources. On the other hand, while export promotion schemes are certainly responsible in part for such diversion of resources, basically it is the pattern of income distribution in the economy and the kind of consumer goods industries it fosters that has led to the absorption of scarce foreign exchange directly and indirectly in low priority uses. What is being advocated by the World Bank is a simultaneous relaxation of import controls all along the line together with devaluation. This would help the low priority industries to consolidate themselves, encourage them to expand further, and result in a much larger amount of foreign exchange getting absorbed in uses of no consequence from the point of view of the development of the economy at this stage. The purpose of liberalization is said to be the fuller utilization of installed capacity in industry, and the case for it is certainly strong in certain engineering industries. But if a general relaxation of import controls is allowed on this ground, it is almost sure to be used at the next stage as an argument for shifting priorities in favor of a pattern of industrial development for which both foreign private capital and aid will more easily be forthcoming in the future, unquote. And Raj concludes his note by pleading, I quote, the problems facing the country are complex. So are the solutions. And one should at least be humble enough to say that one does not quite know how they are all to be tackled. It is enough, however, if one knows the directions in which one needs to move in order to make progress and avoid following false signals and accepting false promises, unquote. The case against free market fundamentalism in economic policy making could not be better stated. It is undoubtedly true that free trade can be a powerful engine of growth and widespread prosperity when it takes place among economies of comparable size and industrial diversification. As James Galbraith has argued in his masterly work, The Predator State, How Conservatives Abandoned the Free Market and Why Liberals Should Too. And I quote Galbraith here, Ricardo was wrong. And I'm alerting all the students of, you know, economics who have been taught comparative advantage theory, please listen carefully to this. Ricardo was wrong. Comparative advantage has very little practical use for trade strategy. Diversification, not specialization, is the main path out of underdevelopment. And effective diversification requires a strategic approach to trade policy. It cannot mean walling off the outside world, but it cannot also be a dogmatic commitment to free trade. Indeed, none of the world's most successful trading regions, including Japan, Korea, Taiwan, and now mainland China, reach their current status by adopting neoliberal trading rules, unquote. The India of the 1980s and 1990s was in a much better position to benefit from globalization than the India of the 1960s and 1970s, when infant industry arguments had meaningful relevance, whatever the free market fundamentalist might say. Just as we find Raj here pleading for greater humility among the practitioners of economics, we must also note his acute discomfort with the trend towards narrowness of vision and concerns in economics of the 20th century. In a remarkable passage in an early CDS working paper titled Village India and Its Political Economy, Raj argues for a more transdisciplinary approach alive to the questions of power in society. And I quote, there is an important set of issues that economic theory has not squarely faced, but which one cannot escape from when dealing with Indian village economies. It concerns the role of power and social values in determining what choices are open to whom and how far they can go in exercising them. In the days when it was common to describe the subject as political economy, the power exercised by different classes of society and their social values were recognized explicitly as important factors governing both resource utilization and income distribution. But such non-quantifiable and otherwise inconvenient dimensions have not received similar attention since then. As more rigor and scientific respectability were sought to be given to it under the new nomenclature of economics, they have come to be treated merely as exogenous elements, more or less on a par with climate and culture, unquote. Raj was at pains to emphasize the need to factor in the specific features of the context being studied while applying theoretical frameworks developed in very different socio-historical contexts, not only across nations, but within a country as diverse as India. Raj was acutely aware that if we continue to ignore the crucial role played by caste relations in village India, economic theory would keep providing us such misleading answers that policy would persist in barking up the wrong tree. He concludes by expressing serious reservations about the state of economics as a profession, words that continue to ring true even today. And I quote, "One has the impression that the majority of economists still find it easier to play the game by the conventional ground rules laid down and approved of by those who invented the game. The alternative, of course, is to follow the much harder path of first studying empirically in depth the complex structures and interrelationships characteristic of traditional agrarian economies before attempting to advance general theories and explanations relying on the methods of conventional economic analysis," unquote. Raj returned to these themes a few years later in a paper written in honor of VKRV Rao, the economist who did a similar investigation in 1952 on the applicability of Keynesian ideas to agrarian economies. Rao's was a path-breaking paper that was standard reading for students of development economics for decades. In my assessment, Raj's paper, written 27 years later, contains even more significant insights. As Raj argues, and I quote, "How the markets are structured, which of them are the crucial ones, and how exactly they function and interact with others are likely to differ not only from one phase of historical evolution to another, but even as between different regions in an agrarian economy. Further complications are introduced when a small section of rural society dominates a number of factor and product markets simultaneously, and these markets are linked by price as well as non-price links. In such situations, the differential positions of participants in any particular market cannot be fitted into conventional models of monopoly and monopsony or absorbed into the framework of general equilibrium analysis. While Keynesian economics, as also general equilibrium analysis, have some insights and clues to offer, their uncritical use without paying adequate attention to these vital features of agrarian economies is still unfortunately all too common today, concealing a great deal of superficiality behind a facade of theoretical elegance and sophistication," unquote. Based on these insights of Raj on rural India, let us now try and gauge what he would have had to say on the current farm crisis. While this is a large question that cannot be fully dealt with in this brief lecture, at least this much we can say with a high degree of confidence. Raj would have urged us to take a much more comprehensive view of the problem and not merely restrict ourselves to interventions in the product market. Based on his understanding of interlocked markets, he would have wanted multiple interventions in the credit, labor, input, land lease, and land markets to go hand in hand with what we do in the market for farm produce. What is more, he would have wanted these reforms to necessarily address the profoundly unequal balance of power in each of these markets, rather than be blinded by a fundamentalist notion of reform implying lesser state intervention, which would end up almost giving farmers more freedom to be exploited. Indeed, in Raj's vision, freedom of choice for the weak and excluded squarely lay in the direction of state support to those who have historically suffered within exploitative social structures, which had excluded many of them from land ownership and forced most of them into relationships of inequality and discrimination. Addressing India's farm crisis requires multiple interventions in all these markets, most especially the credit market, which we will now explore at some length. In order to do this, let us pose another question to Raj. What would Raj have had to say about the current clamor for bank reprivatization. At a time when there is an almost universal view in favor of reprivatization of public sector banks, I think it would be a singular service to listen again to the iconoclastic voice of wisdom embodied by K.N. Raj, who played a key role in providing the intellectual case for the nationalization of banks in 1969. Raj begins, as always, with the basics. He asks, what are the questions monetary policy should concern itself with? And he suggests four questions. One, how much credit is to be made available by banks to borrowers? Two, at what rates of interest? Three, to whom among the potential borrowers and on what criteria? And four, for what purpose? Raj says monetary authorities have restricted themselves to just the first two questions, leaving decisions on questions three and four to the discretion of privately owned banks acting in their own self-interest, operating in an imperfect market, only aggravates already existing imperfections and exclusions. Which is why Raj argues that monetary authorities should also engage with questions three and four. They should be interested in improving the allocation of resources as between competing requirements of different sectors of activity, types of enterprise, and production units. Here, Raj first quotes the Polish economist Michal Kaleski. And I quote the particular quotation from Kaleski that Raj has mentioned in his paper. Quote, the access of a firm to the capital market is determined to a large extent by the amount of its entrepreneurial capital. The most important prerequisite for becoming an entrepreneur is the ownership of capital. Firms below a certain size have no access whatever to the capital market. A state of business democracy where anybody endowed with entrepreneurial ability can obtain capital for starting a business venture is, to put it mildly, unrealistic. Unquote. Thus, Raj concludes that banking enterprises seeking to maximize their profits would not venture into areas and sectors of activity to which high priority needs to be attached from a larger social and economic point of view. Rural credit is not merely a commodity that needs to reach the poor to free them from usurious moneylenders. It is also a public good critical to the development of a backward agrarian economy like India. Building the theoretical case for bank nationalization further, Raj draws upon John Maynard Keynes. In the general theory, Keynes distinguishes between two types of risk that affect the volume of investment. The first is the entrepreneur's risk or borrower's risk, which arises because she is unsure whether her business venture will provide the expected yield. As a borrower, she would naturally want a low rate of interest, especially if a venture is a risky one. But the same situation creates the lender's risk of default by the borrower, which can either be voluntary, what is sometimes called moral hazard, or involuntary due to poor returns on investment. This means that the lender must charge a rate of interest high enough to induce him to lend. Keynes expresses the resulting social dilemma somewhat poetically, and I quote, the hope of a very favorable outcome, which may balance the risk in the mind of the borrower, is not available to solace the lender, unquote. Applying the insights of Keynes and Kaleski to a deeply unequal agrarian economy like India, Raj argues, and I quote, one of the great merits associated with private enterprise is supposed to be that it is enterprising. It is not generally recognized, however, that the very basis of profit making in banking activity sets limits in underdeveloped economies to the enterprise it can display, unquote. There are high information and transaction costs of dealing with many small borrowers that act as a major disincentive. Servicing large numbers of customers who insist on payments in cash on the spot means higher idle cash reserves of banks and lower profitability. Raj showed that mere legislation and control had not led to an optimal allocation of investable resources. Thus, he concluded, nationalization of large banks was the only way forward. Raj was aware that the bureaucratic element in decision-making may introduce considerable rigidity and acknowledged that the danger of such rigidity is indeed considerable within the framework of nationalized banking. But he hastened to add, and I quote, "In large private banks, the element of impersonality, with all the rigidity it introduces, is almost as great as in the case of state-owned banks, except in case of favored customers known to the bank. The larger private banks are no less impervious to the needs of small customers who have no security to offer," unquote. To historically contextualize the theoretical case Raj made for nationalization, it is useful to remember that government control over banking was the norm in most low-income countries in the four decades after the First World War. State control over banking to act as an engine of structural change and the attack on poverty was part of the orthodoxy of development economics at that time. And most recently, after the financial crisis of 2008, with widespread revulsion against Wall Street, a public banking movement has taken off in the United States of America, taking inspiration from the Bank of North Dakota, the only American public bank at that time with a highly successful economic record since its creation in 1918. A non-profit public banking institute was set up in the US in 2011 to advance the cause of public banking nationally. India's own experience stands testimony today to the wisdom of Raj's arguments. The 1961 census had shown that only 50% of India's towns and almost none of our villages had any bank branches at that time. In 1969, at the time of nationalization, not even 1% of India's villages were covered by commercial banks. While industry accounted for a mere 15% of national income, its share in commercial bank credit was nearly 67%. On the other hand, agriculture, that contributed 50% of GDP, at that point virtually got nothing from banks. After nationalization, the number of rural branches of banks increased from a mere 1,443 in 1969 to around 35,000 in the early 1990s. The share of agriculture rose from 0 to 19% by 1990. And it is the easier availability of credit that fueled the investments that drove India's green revolution. And even today, it is these banks which are the biggest formal source of credit at tolerable interest rates in rural India. Of course, as Raj had anticipated, many very serious issues have come up with public sector lending, which call for several reforms, because the policy of social coercion adopted after bank nationalization achieved only limited success. And dependence on usurious rural money lenders actually grew after strict profitability norms were applied to public sector banks in 1991. But over the past one decade or so, very promising progress has been achieved in many parts of India in resolving this trade-off between access to affordable credit and banking profitability. This has happened through the democratization of formal credit, made possible by the program of linking women's self-help groups, SHGs, with public sector banks. This partnership has made inexpensive credit available to the poorest sections of rural India, as banks have been able to reduce transaction costs and improve profitability because of the extraordinary repayment record of these self-help groups. Thus, the way forward does not lie in throwing the baby out with the bathwater through reprivatization. I have been personally involved in the formation of thousands of self-help groups covering more than 50,000 women over the past several years through my organization, Samaj Pragati Sahyog, working in the most deprived parts of central tribal India. These SHGs, with their stellar repayments record and impeccable financial discipline, have not only transformed the lives of lakhs of really poor people, but also helped so many public sector branches to gain profitability. We shudder to think of what will happen to these SHGs and their members once these banks are privatized, as proposed in the Union Budget of 2021. India's most powerful instrument in the battle against poverty could be deeply compromised. As in our long experience so far, we have never found any private bank willing to seriously contemplate lending to the self-help groups. We must also worry about how the impetus to universal financial inclusion, still a distant goal, could falter as a result of bank privatization. Rather than privatization, what is urgently required are bank reforms to improve the quality of their relationship with SHGs and much greater state support to the SHG bank linkage program so that it can reach critical mass and be able to tackle the root of the problem, which lies in unregulated free credit markets, which are so deeply exploitative precisely because they are free. Those arguing for privatization of public sector banks overlook the fact that many of the problems facing the PSBs have arisen precisely through the agency of the government itself, which has had a truly mercenary relationship with public sector banks in recent years. As fiscal stimuli have taken a back seat within the orthodoxy of austerity, and with primacy being given to monetary policy, public sector banks have been repeatedly forced to undertake populist measures such as loan waivers or finance infrastructure projects without requisite due diligence, which have deeply damaged the very integrity of the banking system. Such big ticket loans have led to burgeoning of non-performing assets, which are then seen as a blemish in the performance of public sector banks, not recognizing where the NPAs actually originate. Real public sector bank reform will lie in giving them greater autonomy and professional capabilities rather than privatization, which could well be a real disaster in the making. As Raj argued in almost prescient anticipation of events that have played out closer to our time, and I quote, "Far too much faith has also been placed in India on the ability to detect and check through direct supervision and control by the Reserve Bank, discriminatory lending by private commercial banks in favor of particular parties," unquote. I don't have to elaborate. All of you are aware of the kind of scams that have beset the private banking sector in the last decade. Revisiting K.N. Raj and reading him again has not only been a pleasure, but also a salutary reminder of where economics as an academic discipline has gone, but where it really needs to go. I'm not making an argument against rigor or parsimony, both of which are redeeming features of any scientific discipline. But as Raj warned, when parsimony gets placed at such a high pedestal that it begins to lose touch with reality, and when rigor is defined in terms so narrow that it obfuscates more than it illuminates, then that is clearly an occasion for serious reconsideration of where we are going as a profession. Contrary to those who argue for value neutrality in science, Raj is also alerting us to the need to ground economics on a sound ethical footing. He would have found much solace in the words of Jean Tirole, the 2014 Nobel laureate in economics, which I always read to my students and with which I will end this lecture. I quote Jean Tirole: "Economics is not in the service of private property and individual interest, nor does it serve those who would like to use the state to impose their own values or to ensure that their own interests prevail. It does not justify economies based entirely on the market, nor economies wholly under state control. Economics works towards the common good. Its goal is to make the world a better place. To that end, its task is to identify the institutions and policies that will promote the common good. As absorbing as academic economists might find their intellectual life, collectively, their research must also be useful to society. I place economics within the humanities and social sciences, of which it was a part until the end of the 19th century. In the 20th century, economics developed independently through the fiction of Homo economicus, the hypothesis that decision makers are rational and that they act in their own narrow economic interest. In reality, we are all biased in our thinking and decision making, and we all have goals beyond our material self-interest. Above all, economists must explain what they are good at and what they are bad at too, and with humility and conviction, harness economics for the common good, unquote. I sincerely hope all students of economics, especially the students and faculty at the Center for Development Studies, will move forward this agenda within the transdisciplinary tradition of political economy, never taking their eyes off the gravest problems of our time, especially those afflicting the people and causes without a voice, which were always the ones closest to K.N. Raj's heart. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mihir, for that very wonderful lecture. And I remember when you were our senior here, you always used to say that history should be used very constructively to explain present trends. And that's precisely what you have actually done through the through reading Raj in the current times. Now, I'm going to throw open the lecture for some questions and answers. And before I do that, I also welcome Gopal Raj, whom I see is present in the virtual audience. And I also very warmly welcome all the CDS alumni. Many, a large number of them have turned up for the lecture. A very warm welcome to all of them. Okay, and now I will throw open the floor for discussions. And we have three discussions to begin with. So I would request the discussions to do their roles first, and then after that, anyone from the floor can ask questions. And all they have to do is to basically unmute themselves, ask the question, and then mute themselves. So that will be better for saving the bandwidth. Okay, so I am now requesting the first discussant, Dr. Ram Reddy, who is an old classmate of Dr. Mihir Shah, and also on the governing board of CDS. So Ram, the floor is now open. You could ask
Sunil,
your first
Sunil,
question.
I'm sorry, this is a surprise. I didn't know I was a discussant.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, just give me some time. Wait, just let me come in last. I was not prepared for this.
Okay. Then I call upon Professor Nagaraj, who is also a classmate of Dr. Mihir Shah, and who is currently a visiting professor at the Center for Development Studies. So Nagaraj, I think the floor is open for you.
Yeah. Hello. Hello. Yeah.
We can hear you. Go on. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Mihir, for this excellent lecture. I know since you had shared the text with me, and I had mentioned to you in private what my views were. I think it's a very fine lecture, and I am sure the students will appreciate Raj's contributions in the present context. The way you related his ideas of the devaluation and bank nationalization to present issues of farmers' agitation and privatization of banks that are being proposed, I think that's a brilliant and a connection, both historical connections of ideas and also analytical connections. I think that's a very brilliant So as I mentioned in my comments to you, Mehr, and I would like to share it with the audience here. I think Raj's contributions, I would say, was a fine balance between state and market. You know, I mean, he was definitely one of those, in terms of today's nomenclature, you would say, he was one of those heterodox economists who, not that they did not believe in markets, they were strongly believers in markets, yet they saw the limits of it in the context in which it worked and how markets actually work in historical and social contexts. I think that's a very important part of I would say heterodox economists. Like you mentioned about structural rigidities, like devaluation per se can be good, but if it is combined with other policies which may compromise industrialization strategy of the country, then people like Professor Raj were more cautious against it, more against the similarly, bank nationalization was something which Dr. Raj proposed. At the same time, he was extremely worried how banks can be misused by political class or bureaucratic class in their interests and against the interests of people. I recall this paper by Professor Raj. He wrote in 1982 or 83 in EPW. He called it "Of Peasants and Potatoes." In fact, this was just to give the context. He wrote in this in the context when Balram Jharkhand, as agriculture minister, asked the RBI governor, the then governor I.G. Patel, to resign because he criticized the government policies of loan waivers. And Raj came in defense of Professor I.G. Patel, saying that RBI is an independent institution and it should be protected. Moreover, he was acutely against the misuse of the bank credit for political ends. And he argued that such a policy is going to compromise the bank's financial viability, which is not in the interests of the banks, nor in the interest of the society. So therefore, he maintained a fine balance between, I would say, state and market. I would add one more example here. You know, when often in the context of reforms, a lot of people, you know, accuse Raj of being a great believer in planning and not in markets. Again, that's a completely wrong reading of Raj. I quote, I mean, I don't have quotation, but I refer to I.G. Patel. I.G. Patel argued that in one of his papers that in fact earliest arguments against price controls came from Raj in 1964 in steel industry. In fact, there's a 1964 a committee on price decontrol, steel price decontrol, which was headed by Raj. And this committee came to the conclusion that the steel price controls, which are considered a progressive move, a move for a socialist move, was in fact helping a certain class of steel re-rolling mills, not the public sector enterprises who are made to sell at a subsidized rates. And it was certainly not helping the consumers of steel. So in fact, earliest argument for the control of steel prices as early as 1964 came from Professor Raj. So the point of saying this is that Professor Raj maintained a fine balance between what state can do and what market can do and their limitations. So I think that's one of the finest things which we as students of economics, I think, have to learn. I think that's the most important part of it. And also, Dr. Raj was a deeply nationalist. I mean, I would put him along with Celso Furtado of Brazil, who were deeply aware of the context in which the markets function. So I think this is what makes Raj's contribution unique and also very very contemporary for any developing country context. So I think this is a this is something which we've learned from Raj, and I think I really commend Mihir for bringing these older ideas and connecting with the current issues. And I hope all of us will be are enlightened by this contribution by Mihir. Thank you, Mihir.
Thank you, Nagresh. Thank you so much.
Okay, Mihir, would you like to add anything to what Nagraj said, or you want to listen to others?
No, I think we should proceed with the others. Yeah.
Okay. Then I will now call upon Mr. Vijay Shankar, who also is an old student of CDS, and he works closely with Mihir as well.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Sunil. I mean, listening. Thanks, Mihir, for that wonderful lecture. Listening to you and Nagraj and Ram and Chandan in the audience, Sunil here, Joseph, Das, so many friends, Sundari. So it's like being back in CDS some 30 years ago, 40 years ago, whenever. I don't know how I've lost count of years. It's a very nice lecture, especially about Dr. Professor K. N. Raj, whom I think the current generation knows very little, but issues, kind of issues that he has dealt with, and the way he used to actively and strongly engage. I mean, he was not a weak person. He always, his engagement was always very strong, kind of this thing. He had a very strong view, and he will not mince words about it, like that peasant's potato lecture, which Raghav just now mentioned. I have three questions, which I have listed out here. First is that you talked about market fundamentalism and that being the overarching thing after neoliberal thinking came into force after this Washington Consensus in 1990 or something. You seem to be saying that it's still very robust. But in view of what happened after COVID, the kind of stimulus packages which a lot of governments have come out with, especially the Biden package that you have, do you see some kind of a fiscal consensus emerging which strongly questions the market fundamentalism? I've been listening to, heard that discussion between Olivia Blanchard and Arvind Subramanian, and also the book that Blanchard written with Roderick, which is coming, Danny Roderick, which will be coming out very soon. The role of government is emphasized. So is now the tide shifting? Are we now moving away from market fundamentalism, partly because of financial crisis, partly because of growing inequalities, and more so because of the pandemic, towards something which can be called a fiscal conservatism? The first question. Second is that if you go back to those debates of agriculture on agriculture in the 1960s and the 1970s, in which Raj, Sukumar Chakrabarty, many others were participating, there was a constant opposition between technology and institutions, or the technology standing in for green revolution and institutions standing in for land reform. That was a constant refrain, and Raj very strongly was in support of land reform and saying that without land reform, green revolution or the new technology is likely to increase inequalities rather than solve problems. But looking at that debate now with a history of around 30 years or something, do you think, do you feel that they have underemphasized the role of technology somewhat and probably overemphasized the role of land reform? Of course, land reform never got a chance in India. But even then, did they, was a person like Raj not very incorrect in underestimating the technology of green revolution, etc.? Now we have developed a critique of green revolution. You have been in the forefront of developing a new critique, but that's on ecological grounds. That's not really what Raj opposed green revolution for. So looking at that debate, how do you look at it? That's my second question. And third is that a very large question, talking about land reforms. We have now, India is a country of small and marginal farmers. 80 to 90% of our farmers are small and marginal, cultivating roughly 50% of the total land. In that kind of a situation, what do you think is the role of state and market respectively in the ensuring the sustainability and survival of small and marginal farmers? Those are three questions which I had, which is related to your lecture. Thank you. Thank you so much. Yeah.
So, Sunil, should I respond?
Yes, please. Please.
Thank you. Okay.
I think the first point is really interesting because, post-COVID or post-Biden, definitely a rethinking is underway. In fact, I would go as far as to say that, between the 1930s and the 1970s, is what is sometimes called the golden age of capitalism. Okay, that was the Keynesian era. From 1980, say till today, we have gone through the age of free market fundamentalism. And, you know, in Hindi, where I'm sitting in my tribal village, we say, Tumhare muh mein ghee shakkar, which means that let us hope what you are saying, they will be prophetic words, that from, you know, the 2020s onwards, we may actually be now entering a new era where free market fundamentalism is finally junked, and the huge inequalities that it has given rise to, the crisis of the planet that it has given rise to, we are living also in the age of the Anthropocene, which I did not mention in this lecture because Professor Raj was not really talking so much about ecological issues. But for us, this is extremely important that we are also in the age of the Anthropocene, where human action is actually leading to the destruction of the planet. So let's put it this way, that if we don't wake out of free market fundamentalism, if we don't step out of this orthodoxy, very soon there'll be no time left to deliberate these issues, because the crises that are coming upon us are not just economic crisis, not just the crisis of poverty and unemployment and inequality, but also of planetary destruction. So I, you know, we can see openings in that direction, but I don't see a new consensus. If you are asking me that, it's not a consensus. You look at the students of economics across the world, not just in India, they are still learning mainly the same orthodox economics. It's therefore, as Nagaraj was saying, it's still heterodox what we are saying. So let's hope this heterodoxy will, even if not become mainstream, will have a far greater presence with the work of young economists like Mariana Mazzucato. I have a lot of hope that maybe we will be seeing with modern monetary theory, etc. We could be seeing the final decline of austerity and free market fundamentalism. Your second question on technology and institutions. Look, I think if anything, if Professor Raj was biased in favor or arguing in favor of institutional reform, it is he who has been vindicated over time. Because even though it is true that technology did lead to rise in agricultural productivity, and it's not agricultural productivity, as you know, it's essentially wheat and rice. It was not a green revolution, it was a wheat and rice revolution. And the kind of technology and the unsustainability that it ensured is actually underscoring the importance of institutional factors, which we have just completely ignored. When I have talked about the balance of power in markets, etc., it is essentially about institutions. Without building powerful people's institutions, the future of Indian democracy, the future of an inclusive economy is in great danger. So I would say that's another very important reason to remember Raj, and remember Raj in very favorable terms, is what I would say. I think the technology, which of course played its role, is actually now highly discredited. So even the use of technology, the evolution of technology, where the role of indigenous knowledge, you know, the new kind of discourse that we are now seeing, that is where we are taking a very new view of technology itself, which again can be said to owe to a certain institutional view of technology itself. Now, you asked a large question on the role of the state and markets. I mean, I think that's what partly I was trying to talk about in the lecture, that especially given that we have, you know, more than 85% of India's farmers are small and marginal farmers. And here we have, and it's not just this government, look, this move towards liberalizing agriculture markets is something which has been discussed for the last 20 years. And, the view that somehow the small farmer can go and compete in a market which is going to get completely dominated by large agri giants from across the world is terrifying, if I may say so. And therefore, again, underscores the importance not only of state intervention, but, you know, as I've briefly alluded to in the lecture, of civil society action, that we have to get powerful institutions of farmers, and in each case led by women. You know, women's institutions hold the future, you know, for this economy, for this planet. Without powerful institutions led by women and, you know, given direction by women, we are not going to be able to solve the problems of farming or of any of the other crises that we face. So once again, it's not about state versus markets. As Nagaraj rightly pointed out, markets can be marshaled in favor of the weakest people in this country only if and only if they are mobilized and they become powerful entities who can actually compete in these markets, which currently are deeply exploitative of small and marginal farmers. So I think rather than getting into this versus that debate, I think state action to facilitate civil society mobilization and to regulate markets. You know, without the state, there is no market. I mean, this, you know, when I teach in my classes, I ask students, what are the features of, what do you define as a capitalist economy? And the last feature, I put a question mark and it's kind of a puzzle. And the last feature is the state. Without the state, capitalism would not have existed and would not have existed in at least the kind of form in which it becomes somewhat acceptable to people, because otherwise it is, you know, there was a phrase socialism or barbarism in when we were young and when we were in CDS. So whether it is socialism or not, it is certainly the other side is barbarism. You know, if we go into this free market fundamentalist kind of vision of society and economy, we are heading towards a major destruction, a destruction which was not actually even anticipatable in the early 20th century, except by very prescient thinkers like Gandhi, if I may say so. But I think I've given too long an answer to your questions.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mihir, and also thank you, Vijay Shankar, for those questions. Now I request Dr. Ram Reddy to ask his questions. I hope he's ready.
Sorry, Sunil. I'm not an easy speaker, so I would have had to prepare for to be a discussant. Anyway, Mir, it is, as the others have said, a fascinating lecture. And thank you for revisiting the work of Raj in many respects. I'll confine myself to three comments, less of questions and more of comments. First is, thank you for talking about how Raj would have seen the farmers' protests. Not so much about in terms of what his recommendations would have been, but how he may have understood the problem. And there, as you have said very rightly, he would have realized that given the multiple interactions in the agriculture, rural markets, not agricultural markets, a fundamental problem which not many people have spoken about, if you have, yes, is that the farm laws look at it everything from the point of view of the product market. They assume that, one, that the prices will improve for the farmers and therefore aggregate well-being will go up. I mean, let us forget that assumption for a moment. What they have ignored is the multiple interactions which are still in rural markets as they were 50, 70 years ago when Raj studied the phenomenon of rural markets. And there I'm glad that you pointed out how much of Raj's work on rural markets led to, you know, significant work later. I mean, much of Amit Bhaduri's work, much of Krishna Bharadwaj's work was actually all rooted in Raj's work, and they built on his ideas. So I would say that his understanding of the situation today would be far richer than what many economists and policymakers have put forward. It is not just market fundamentalism. It is market fundamentalism of a peculiar kind. You know, it's a sort of a waving magic wand. And there, I'm glad that you've spoken about this aspect. The second is to kind of endorse what Nagaraj had said, that he really had you couldn't say that he was pro-market, pro-planning, etc. He had this very fine balance, and that often, I think, infuriated fellow economists who wanted to pin him or slot him. You know, he couldn't be slotted. And right through, you know, from the 50s onwards, he maintained this balance. And post 1991 as well, You see, that was the other thing. He was not afraid of posing questions or revisiting his views. And post 1991, he really did look again more closely at planning, that what was right and, you know, what was wrong and what needed to be changed. Unfortunately, those were not his best decades. So we don't really know how he saw things in great detail. Finally, I just want to make one point. This is not something that fitted into your topic of your lecture. You see, he was an advisor to, you know, three prime ministers, many chief ministers. But we also know that, like a true advisor, he was not afraid to be critical. I mean, that is something, you know, we need to revisit, because today we find that advisors are not just fearful of those whom they are supposed to give advice to. Advisors also want to anticipate what the people who are giving advice to want them to hear, you know. So he was you know that he was a very close advisor to Indira Gandhi to a certain point of time. But even in that period, like on devaluation, he was not afraid to give contrary advice. So somewhere I wish that we had economists today in India, and I don't know what the situation is in the US or elsewhere, that dissent is extremely important, you know, when you're listening, when you ask for people's advice. And that he did, you know, he did to, I don't know about, you know, his work in the Planning Commission, his interactions with the Prime Minister at that time. But we know that, you know, he was at times very critical of what Indira Gandhi was planning or did. And even later, briefly, when he was a member of the Economic Advisory Council to Rajiv Gandhi, he was not afraid to speak his mind. So one wishes that today we have to have a generation of advisors who are honest in what they say, not dissenting for the sake of dissenting, but being honest. So I just wanted to make these three brief points about how he would have seen the farmers' protests, or pointed out the poor understanding of rural India. Second, about the balance that he maintained between planning and the market, and as how he saw himself as an advisor.
Thank you, Ram. The remarkable comments, really. Very true.
Okay. Mihir, would you like to respond to that, or you don't? You can.
No, I don't really agree with what Ram said. Yes.
Okay. Now, I throw open the floor to anyone who's interested in making a comment or asking Mihir a question. I can see in the chat box, S. Krishna Kumar has made some comments. So if S. Krishna Kumar would like to make that openly, he's very welcome to do so. Otherwise, it's open to anyone.
Anyway, I have written it just because I thought that sometimes one part of Professor K. Indira Gandhi is ignored, is that he was part of a very great plan development process, but along with it, he also found how effectively his engagement in the world of policy making could get translated into celebrated theoretical articles in Oxford Economic Papers, along with Amartya Sen and alternative strategies of growth under limited foreign exchange. But another thing, I think when I heard Professor Sierra, Mr. Sierra Reddy, I thought I should ask a question to Professor Mihir Shah, that there are now a series of reports worldwide, governmental reports at that, which are highly critical and highly critical inputs, particularly the governmental reports on big tech in America, the Financial Crisis Inquiry Committee report in the United States, and even in our own country with respect to data management. There is a big committee under the leadership of Chris Gopalkrishnan and others. So number of places we find that there are number of reports which are highly giving highly critical and useful inputs to those in the government. But somehow, is it that there is not a sufficiently vibrant civil society which would provide the much needed
much needed strength for the translation of these sorts of inputs into policy sphere, that sometimes the critical reports are there, but the policy is going in another direction. I thought I should be asking you this question because you're heavily engaged in various spheres of civil society activism, Professor Shah.
No, I think you're quite right that there are people, I'm myself quite engaged in proposing a water policy. You know, I've just chaired a national committee to draft a new national water policy, and we are very critical of what successive governments have done. Actually, since independence, it's essentially the same water policy we've had, and we are still waiting to see how the government responds. We have submitted the first draft, etc. I think what matters most in policy reform being taken seriously is the kind of pressure that is brought to bear from below. You know, if, for example, in water, if it becomes an issue on which elections are won and lost, I can tell you water policy will change as quickly as we can imagine. So I think it's about aligning the suggestions, the critical suggestions that you're talking about, which are made at the policy level, with ground level action. And if that is not happening or doesn't seem to have the space for it to happen, I think that's where the constraint seems to come. When that begins to happen, we see change happening even in the highest echelons of policymaking in government. So I think both going together is what is required for effective policy change to be enacted. That's a brief answer I can give you.
Okay, thank you, Mihir. Okay. Anyone else would like to ask any questions now?
Good evening, sir. I'm Srivatsan. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. Please,
yes,
go on.
Yes, sir. I would like to know your view on the increasing NPAs in public banks, sir, and the reason behind it, the solutions without privatizing the banks. I mean, when I say privatizing, I'm not expecting it to be privatized completely. I have read some suggestions given by some economists like Raghunam Rajan, sir, telling the horizontal income disparity between public sector banks and private sector banks, and some other institutional problems for the increase in NPAs. So is there any other way to solve the problem without privatizing?
Right. You know, I think I tried to briefly address that in the lecture and drawing upon Professor K.N. Raj's insights. See, we tend to forget sometimes that there was a time when all banks in India were private, you know, except for the State Bank of India, which from the 30s has been nationalized. Essentially, all banking in India was private other than, you know, that exception. So, and it was something which excluded the vast majority of India's people from the benefits of banking. I mean, you are all subject to a kind of usurious money lending. So I think we need to remember that first, you know, because that's a huge fact. Even today, financial inclusion is not yet been achieved at the scale that we want to achieve. So we need to keep that in mind when we ask this question. Now let's go into the NPA question as to why they have arisen. And I've tried to hint at the kind, you know, Professor Nagaraj also spoke about it, that from the time, you know, last 30, 40 years, this loan mela business, then loan waiver, then the kind of infrastructure push that is being given. See, this is the balance between fiscal policy and monetary policy, which has gone wrong, which is what I'm calling free market fundamentalism. If you believe that you have to keep the fiscal deficit to a certain level, and if it rises even slightly above that, as if it's a God-given law, the all hell is going to break loose, then you have, you know, pushed yourself into a corner where this NPA problem is bound to arise, which means you are going to push banks without due diligence on the nature of projects they are financing, and you're going to continuously have happening performing assets. So I think you understand that a bank must be allowed to work with professional autonomy. See, whether it's private or public control, what's happening in private control banks? Look at the non-regulation, the weak regulatory state that we have in India, Look at what's happened. I mean, I don't want to name any names, but it's all in front of you. The kind of scams that have happened in our private sector banks, which are supposed to be these great professional institutions. I think what matters is oversight. What matters is professionalism and autonomy in functioning, and very clear goals which have to be set out. You know, the example I gave is not very popular in the pink paper circles, which is of the self-help groups of women, because that doesn't sort of, you know, the normal people of this country, the common people of this country don't figure in the kind of economic debates we have today. It was not the case in Professor Raj's time. In Professor Raj's time, they were the primary concern of all policy making. Today, it's something else. It's a rarefied universe in which we all live. But if you go to see the work happening through public sector banks, this is not a work of charity, okay? This is not social coercion of Indira Gandhi. This is professional banking, which has improved profitability of public sector banks in remote tribal rural areas of this country. So we are not asking for charity from banks at all. In fact, that is what destroys banks. If you do loan waiver, if you do, you know, just political expediency is going to destroy the banking system. That is what has led to these NPAs. We need to free them from that kind of political manipulation while ensuring their autonomy and professionalism and strengthening, I'm saying, their relationship with powerful institutions of the poorest people of this country led by women. This is something which is not being paid attention to. Of course, we, you know, when I was in the Planning Commission, we initiated what is called the National Rural Livelihoods Mission. It has this thinking behind it. But how far have we taken that mission? How far have we strengthened the hands of public sector banks to be able to do that and to perform with profitability? So I'm not arguing for, you know, abandoning profitability norms. There is a win-win which can be created. And then I mentioned the public banking, you know, movement in the United States. What it is, Wall Street crash 2008, there is a big revival in you know, an energy for public bank. And, you know, even in a country has been like he said, Gilles always says, do what the Americans do what they just are always in their dealings with. You know, countries now with India, they don't have much mileage, but, you know, countries in Africa, Latin America, they are pushing their interests. But actually, if you see what's happening in their own backyard, it's a very different story.
I have a question, Mihir. This is Mridul here. Hello, Mihir.
Can you hear me? Mridul, you could ask. I think he's having some connectivity problem. Just hold on for a minute, and
can you hear me?
He's having some difficulty, I think. Yes, yeah, we can hear you. We can hear you. Okay.
Yeah. Hello, Mihir. I just wanted to say hello, and I wanted to ask you two questions actually. One, you know, to do with Raj, but the other one is what you mentioned about the women. I mean, you know, the self-help groups. So let's just say about Raj, what I had found absolutely fascinating about the way he worked was the fact that, you know, he borrowed from existing theories, of course, theories of not the neoliberal type, but the theories of the classical type. He borrowed from Kaleski, he borrowed from Keynes, and he also Marx, whom you didn't mention at all, but, you know, he had the influence of Marx in a way in his mind, because he did talk about class analysis and things. So he borrowed from them, and then he actually came out with something which was very pertinent to the specific situation, and it actually went beyond orthodoxy. For instance, the whole commercialization.
I'm sorry, I have an internet problem, I think. Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you, but did you hear me at all? Did you hear me at all?
Hello?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
I can, yeah.
2D agenda. Okay, I don't know whether you could hear what my full answer to.
No, Mihir, I think we are not able to hear you. Okay, maybe you could switch off your, you can stop your video, that will give you more bandwidth.
Yeah, we'll stop the video. I'll also stop my video.
Oh, yes, Mridul, you could.
Can you hear me? Sunil, can
Yes.
you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. We can
Okay,
hear
okay.
you. Okay.
All right. No, no, I lost the internet for a few minutes. Yeah, thank you.
Yes.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to say, Mihir, of course, absolutely fantastic what you spoke. I mean, I'm not saying anything more than that. But, you know, there's one thing about Raj that I had wanted to comment on, and another thing about the women that you talked about, the self-help groups. Now, Raj, the thing which had really impressed me, and, you know, I was absolutely amazed by the way he could do it, you know, where he got the ability to theorize on the basis of what is happening in the actual situation, borrowing from other theories, but building up something, you know, which is much more pertinent to what is happening in a specific situation. There's a whole commercialization debate. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes, please go.
So, you know, the whole commercialization, you know, he sort of shifted the whole thing from development of capitalism in agriculture to the development of commercialization in agriculture. So I'm saying this was something which amazed me about him, that he was so grounded in reality and could actually even theorize, you know, taking off from there. So this was one thing I thought. And I think he borrowed not only from Kalesky and Keynes, he borrowed from Marx also. He was not a Marxist, but he did borrow from Marx's analysis and a way of analyzing things. So this is one thing I wanted to say to you. The second thing was about the women's self-help groups. You know, the thing which has always been a little bit surprising to me is that we always talk about these women in self-help groups, and they're remaining at a certain level. They're remaining at a certain level, and they are probably very empowered at that level. But they are, you know, we are not seeing women being empowered at higher levels of decision making, higher levels of authority. You know, that sort of a thing, somewhere they get lost. So what is this? How come they are so much empowered at the local grassroots level? But somehow the other, now, I may also add that, for instance, Kudumbashree women, this time there are about 7,000 Kudumbashree women who got into the local bodies. And there were about 2,000 and odd Narega workers who got into the local bodies. So there has been a progress upwards, but I'm saying that they don't go beyond that. So that is something I wanted to know your views about. What is it which constrains the women and leaves them at that level?
No, Mridul, that's the, you know, the big question. And, you know, you're talking about Kudumbashree, and that's for, you know, sometimes I've lived and worked in central India. And you know the situation, I always say Kerala is a different planet. I mean, it's not even a different state or a different country. It's that difference, the gap between what happens south of the Narmada and what happens to the north of it. So it's to do with these, you know, centuries old patriarchal relations, which have shaped attitudes towards women in all dimensions of life. So, you know, I think these are building blocks at a certain level. And from that, like you said, even the, you know, the women we have been able to work with, they have started getting represented in elected bodies, etc. But it's a long battle. You look at the history that we are fighting against. So I think it has to do with that. And at the same time, if I may say so, it's the collapse of the left at the national political level. I mean, I'm sorry for being so blunt, but that's as simple
yeah,
as that.
You're too blunt. You're too blunt for me.
But that's what it is. You know, if that was the leadership, these are all conditions ripe for the left to, you know, intervene and give them momentum. But where is that happening? Where is the imagination of those parties? How much of their leadership has? So, you know, that has been a big constraint. I had hoped that, you know, with so many of our, you know, beloved friends and, you know, comrades who are joining the leadership of these parties, that that would lead to a transformation. But, you know better than me about all of that. So I think that is a major constraint.
We are trying, Mihir, we are trying. Definitely in Kerala, we are trying. Okay, let me assure you.
Sure. I can understand. Yes.
Okay, thank you, Mridul, for that question. Anyone else would like to ask?
Yeah, may I ask?
Yes, Professor Kannan, yes, please.
This is Amol, am I?
Okay.
Can I ask a question or?
Yes, of course you can.
Hello, sir. Very, very interesting to get updates about Professor Shah. For a whole generation of economists and economic students, we lost out learning from him, and I'm very jealous that some of you learned under him, and I mean we get to hear so about his work and so on and so forth. So very interesting. So I had a parallel question to the banking one. Now the government has announced a new development financial institution, and our past experiences with DFIs has been similar to the public sector banks in the sense that they all started with the right intent, but that intent really got lost out and too much of government interference and so on and so forth, which led the IDBIs and the IFCIs and all the others, I think barring ICICI, which converted into a retail bank much earlier, most of them continue to struggle. So what would Professor Shah's approach, or what would Professor Shah suggest or recommend on this new DFI? What should it really do? And so on and so forth. Thank you, sir.
I think the answer is on very similar lines to what I was saying earlier.
Right,
that, as you said, you know, if it continues to be beset with the kind of political interference and political expediency serving partisan political ends rather than genuine, you know, national development agendas, you know, that's what K.N. Raj is talking about when he's envisioning a public sector in banking. So we need to actually have that kind of vision where we are talking of infrastructure development, which is based on realistic assessments of what the economy can sustain. It cannot be the way we have driven these banks to fund, you know, projects which are just kind of a, you know, laundry wish list of certain kinds of political leaders and do not have that kind of very rigorous vetting in terms of their viability. What are the linkages in the economy that they will give rise to? I mean, I am reminded of the days of, you know, Sukhumai Chakrabarty and the kind of rigor that was brought into, you know, development planning. I think that without that, and, you know, that's the work of Mariana Mazzucato and the modern monetary theorists that I was referring to. I'd strongly, you know, refer all of you to read that work, because she's actually working out these as practical solutions for a large number of countries in Europe, for example. So I'm not just talking of some theoretical formulation. This is actual real policy making, especially in the sphere of development banking. So I think we have examples. She's working with the government of Palestine, for example, also. And they could give us kind of pointers. But we are currently looking at some other kinds of examples which are not really leading us in the right direction, I'm sorry to say.
So, I mean, just a follow-up, can I?
No, there is actually another person who wants to ask.
Sorry. Okay.
Maybe
sorry.
You could do that after that, okay? So now I'll call upon Tara to ask a question. Tara?
Yeah, thanks, Mihir, for that wonderful trip through Dr. Raj's sort of intellectual legacy. Thanks so much for that. And I'm extremely sorry to again take you back to the question on SHGs and self-help groups, because it was a wonderful, you know, hearing from you that, you look at that as that innovation as something which has really democratized the, the banking space. I have two questions on that. One is it important to recognize the role of adequate and appropriate social intermediation, which sort of help channelize that kind of bank funds to these women? Because I don't think an automatic a translation of that kind of and just an innovation like SHG wouldn't have automatically translated into something like that, democratization of that nature. So and that's a space which is really getting shrunk and, which is constantly being questioned and contested now, which I think I see as a major challenge. The second challenge, I would say that, this social intermediation at some point in time has been co-opted by the political processes, which I think also has, we are in a great hurry to create these exemplary examples of you know, state-run programs, I think, which has definitely harmed the core of you know, SEG as a very soulful innovation that we thought of. The associated thing I have is, you know, in hindsight, sometimes you know, it looks to me that that was a clever ploy to financialize the social space, or at least it has been used by you know, at least some you know, elements to accelerate the financialization process through sort of, you know, manipulating the SEG methodology to bring in, you know, other. So somewhere I think inclusion became a financial sector expansion, financialization through those institutions. And I think my question is, what can we do to counter some of these tendencies in the larger sort of.
No, thank you, Tara, for those very insightful observations. I think intermediation is absolutely critical. You know, I was talking of the planets, whatever, Central India, North India. Things are so dismal that without that kind of intermediation, without empowerment, without facilitation, things were not going to change. And that is the way it has happened. That's where the role of the government actually is so important, that to facilitate the possibilities of this intermediation, we need state intervention, because again, you know, it's not going to spontaneously happen. So I absolutely take that point, and it's very important. Political co-option, see, that's the eternal battle. I mean, as soon as something becomes successful, there is always going to be an attempt at, and as you said, there's a great hurry, and that hurry is what destroys the possibility. Because these are slow maturing, you know, entities. Institution building is a slow process, and quality institution building will only happen in time with proper preparation, capacity building. It's not going to happen otherwise. And you're right that that kind of rush in order to be able to show something which we have achieved has been a big problem here. Now, this clever ploy argument, I mean, that is, see, on the one hand, it's true that what we call the MFIs, the microfinance institutions, are an extremely dangerous development in this space. And we all know what has happened. The government of Andhra Pradesh had to crack down upon them, etc. The whole sector is still in a tizzy because of the malpractices. And this word malpractice, I'm not using as an activist and trying to say something negative about what is being done. This is a industry, you know, terminology, as I'm sure you are aware, but others may not be so aware. So malpractice is well defined by the financial inclusion industry, and people are studied on the basis of whether they are indulging in those malpractices. And the microfinance institutions are definitely doing that. Now, as you said, if the focus is on financial inclusion rather than on deepening democracy, so this is where the perspective is very important. What is the perspective with which we are talking about the SEG movement? Is it about deepening democracy? Is it about more inclusive development? If it is not that, if it's only financialization, then there's going to be a problem. So I think we have a very successful model, I believe, which does all of these things. It does empowerment, it builds women's leadership, it strengthens the roots of democracy, it makes participation in Gram Sabhas go up, it makes the panchayat decisions more democratic, etc. And as Mridul was saying, hopefully this can, you know, impact higher and higher levels of governance. But when the focus is purely on making credit quickly and cheaply available, and it's driven by the profit motive of a microfinance institution, then the kinds of consequences you are speaking about will happen. But, you know, I'm just cautioning against a lot of people, you know, talk of feminization of debt as a result of the SEG program. I think the best way of answering that question is to ask the women themselves, because it is true they are investing a lot of time and energy in building these institutions. It takes a lot, but it's entirely their choice and their decision. And, you know, all of you are welcome to come and see the work some of us have done over decades, and I'm sure you've seen examples of that elsewhere as well, where, you know, very, very authentic, powerful institutions of the weakest, most vulnerable people led by women have come into existence and are impacting a lot of things, including provision of government services, the state of hospitals and schools and our remote areas. All of this must become part of, that's why I'm calling deepening democracy. Without that, it becomes, you know, as you were saying, a financialization effort, which will then also lead to negative consequences.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tara, and also
I
thank
had
you.
A question, Sunil.
Yes.
Sunil, I had a
question. Yes, Amit, please go. Okay.
Hello, Amit, yes.
Yeah, thanks for a lovely exposition. really took me back, and thanks to all of you, took me back to my days in CDS. Mihir, I really admired your lecture, but there were some things, you know, which not related to you, but maybe you could throw light on, especially in terms of your practice.
Amit, your voice is breaking.
Oh, again, a bandwidth problem. See, from the day I first met Raj, one of the things when even while interviewing me, he had talked about the rise of religious fundamentalism.
Can you hear Amit? Is it my problem?
Yes, we can hear him. It's Amit, please speak close to the to your microphone.
Yeah, I'm, the mic is almost in my mouth. Can you hear me now?
Yes, of course. We can hear
now
you.
I can. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Almost while interviewing me for coming to CDS, we had talked about the growth of religious fundamentalism and how religious fundamentalism goes hand in hand almost with what you call free market fundamentalism. He had in fact used the term extra economic force, which, you know, I recently wrote a paper in the Journal of Peasant Studies. I bring that out. Now, with the kind of growth of religious fundamentalism and casteism, which has bearings even on the SHG movement, like I've been very associated with it in Eastern UP, I find that even 10 years ago, what was achieved, that women of different caste and religious groups sitting together, now they refuse to do that. And in that kind of a scenario, what do we do? Secondly, about civil society, you are very well aware of all the curbs, all the, you know, the, let's say, the decimation of all the freedoms we had. All the civil liberties are gone, and if you've seen the labor, the four codes. So we are heading for a very dismal situation, the planet of which I was a part once, notwithstanding. So where do we go from here is a question I have. The second thing I have, you know, you had once mentioned, I think this is several decades ago, that what NGOs do becomes a footnote, I mean, a box in a report.
We are not able to hear you yet.
I don't know.
Sunil, are you able to?
Yeah, we are able to hear him.
Yes, we are able to hear him, but there is little.
Okay, maybe echo. Then it's problem on my side. I don't know.
Could you get the gist of what I said?
Yeah. We got it clearly. Go ahead, please.
So the second thing is, you know, that, I mean, I think Mihir had said sometime about what, 2 decades ago, that what NGOs do becomes a full, I mean, a box in a report. How do we make that box into the full report? Mihir?
Hello?
Mihir, are you there?
Mihir, you have to unmute.
Yes, sorry. No, I have missed a lot of what you're saying, but I think I got a general drift about the problems of civil society space shrinking.
I just stop you here. I mean, something which I used to share with Raj, even in my meetings with him in Delhi, is the growth of religious fundamentalism along with free market fundamentalism.
Okay. Right.
I don't think he wrote about it, but he used to talk about it quite often, even to you.
Right. No, I think fundamentalisms of all kinds, we have experienced many in our short lifetime, pose great dangers, as we all know. My approach has been actually slightly different from, say, many of my colleagues, you know, over the years, who I was with in CDS. I have actually taken the route of exploring more deeply the spiritual traditions that this country and other countries have had. And when I wrote a paper in the India Forum on Babasaheb Ambedkar and his engagement with, you know, I called it the political radicalism of Ambedkar's spirituality. And I feel that is the only way of actually showing what a tradition actually stood for. That's the best way of countering what goes on in the name of religious fundamentalism, which goes across the board. I mean, I remember also that sometimes the fundamentalism of the left I used to counter by referring to what Marx says in Capital, etc. So it's an old, well-worked strategy. But I do believe that We need to engage with what the people actually believe in, why they believe in it, what is the kind of essence that we can derive from, you know, the worth of those beliefs. And that gives us a new opening into, you know, I have worked in an area, you know, all these 30 years where the problems you speak about have always been there. And this is the way we were able to negotiate the space, you know, which otherwise would have, you know, been almost impossible when we first came. We didn't know, we didn't have the language even to talk to people. But I think we learned also, I think we need to have openness to listen to people, to understand where their concerns are coming from, and then not giving up on any of what we fundamentally believe. We need to build a dialogue with what the spiritual traditions say. I mean, I called it Ambedkar's pantheon. If you look at whether it's Gandhi, it's Martin Luther King, if bell hooks, it's Thich Nhat Hanh. These are activists I deeply respect. And they all have had a spiritual core at the foundation of their politics. And I think that gives us a far better, a stronger basis for countering any kind of fundamentalism, I would say, not just religious fundamentalism, but any kind of fundamentalism.
Okay, thank you, Amit, and thank you also, Michael. I think we have now reached the fag end of the lecture because it's almost like 10 minutes past 5 o'clock. And I take this opportunity to thank Mihir for this very wonderful lecture. And he has really taken us an excursion into Raj's writing and has made them very relevant for understanding current problems. And we look forward to having Mihir in our midst whenever we are able to resume in-person activity. And I think this is a very wonderful way of celebrating our 50th foundation year. And I can see so many of the CDS alumni participating in today's lecture, you know, and that's been really wonderful. We have never had so many Mihir for these lectures. And so that's been really wonderful. And, you know, Mihir has done it very systematically. For instance, he has been writing, he has written this lecture out, and he has been showing this to various people to get comments. And, you know, I suppose he will give it back to us to publish it. And, you know, and because this will be the first Ken Raj Memorial lecture. And this will add to the 3 other public lectures that we have at the center. The Foundation Day lecture, the B.J. Kumar lecture, and the P.K. Gopalakrishnan Memorial lecture, you know, and this will be the 4th one in that series. So I thank Mihir and I thank Ram Nagaraj and Vijay Shankar and all others who have participated. And I thank Gopal Raj for participating in today's discussions. His brother is not keeping well, otherwise we would have had him also. So it is really wonderful to celebrate, to remember Raj in this way, you know. And our valedictory lecture in the 50th foundation year is about a week from now on the 22nd of this month at 3:30 p.m. And it is by Professor Errol D'Souza, who is the director of the Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad. And he's actually going to speak on something which we talked about today, which should governments be in the business of banking? And that is his topic of lecture. So I welcome all of you to, you know, come and attend that lecture as well. So thank you, all of you, and especially to Mihir. And we look forward to seeing you all back again. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Sunil, for giving this opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye, Mihir.
Thank you.
Bye.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I will now end the lecture.